to this molecular medicine partnership unit. And just for full disclosure, we have some funding from GSK and Sanofi, and I got some consultancy from a small company called Travel. So with that said, let's get into the topic of today. And so as also Carl said, now we're going to move more towards networks-based approaches. And I like to motivate the use of biological knowledge and more general the use of biological mechanistic information. And of course, the starting point for all the work that we are seeing here is how we can use different omics data, multi-omics data set, to better understand and better treat cancer patients. And this data, as you'll be seeing, is different type of molecular data, but also different levels of resolutions, including all the single cell and spatial data that was also discussed today, and something I will come back later. And even, you know, you can add other things such as microbiome and whatnot. So regardless of the data that you have, the direct approach to deal with this in the context of machine learning, which is also the focus of this course, is to say, okay, I'm going to input my data into my favorite or the most advanced machine learning, deep learning, or statistical method. And with this method, I will try to find relationships between the molecular data and either a disease phenotype, disease progression, or the efficacy of the drugs. And we have worked on this, and many groups have worked on this. And what we use over many years to study this is large cancer cell line collections that are available from, on one hand, the Broad Institute in Boston, and on the other hand, the Sanger Institute near Cambridge, where you have thousands of cell lines with different of these omics data, gene expression, mutation, and so forth. And then all these cell lines come from different organs, like in real tumors, each tumor type is different, but also between a given tumor type, between a given tissue of origin, there are different tumors, so you try to recapitulate this with collection of cell lines. And then you try to predict the efficacy of the drugs on these cell lines. You have many cell lines and a number of drugs. And then you try to see whether you can predict with machine learning or any method, whether from the molecular data across the thousand cell lines, you can predict the efficacy of the drugs. Typically, you look at the IC50, you know, how much drug you need to kill half of the cells. And we try from very simple linear models to more advanced Bayesian multitask learning, and many other groups have developed methods for this. And if you try these pure machine learning models directly, in some cases it works really well and generally certainly allow us to learn many things. But if you look critically, the predictability is often low. So for many drugs, just with machine learning, we cannot predict whether a drug is going to kill a particular cancer cell line or not. And even worse is interpretability. So even when the models work, we don't really know why. We don't really understand why a drug is killing certain cancer cells. What is the mode of action, or how the mode of action interfaces with the molecular wiring of a particular cell. So for this reason, what we put a lot of emphasis in our group is into supporting these machine learning methods with biological knowledge. As I will show you what we try to do and other groups do, and you will hear more approaches in this course, is to extract from this omics data signatures. Signatures can be diverse, but the main idea is that rather than to look at all genes, like 20,000 genes or so, you look at a smaller collection of signatures, maybe a few dozens of pathways or a few hundreds of transcription factors that you extract from using the knowledge and the data. And by doing this, on the one hand, you are reducing the number of features that are the input for your model. Therefore, you reduce dimensionality, and this means an increase in the statistical power and the capacity of the model to give you good predictions. But also these features are rooted in mechanisms in biological knowledge, and therefore they are directly interpretable and more useful for understanding of what's going on. The first thing that we need for this is prior knowledge, and to facilitate the use of many sources of biological knowledge, we developed over the years this resource called OmniPath. And OmniPath is no more than one-stop shop, so it's one way to access now over 100 different public available resources. We started looking at pathways and kind of networks inside the cells. Over the years, we added different things like complexes, annotations and localization. And more recently, because we also got interested in the single cell that, as I said before, you also heard about, and I will come back to it later, we had a particular recent focus on cell-cell interactions and in all the information about, yeah, how cells talk to each other and how cells interact with each other. And here you can see, for example, how we added over 15 resources from different groups that tell you about how cells interact. So all this knowledge is really available. We also put a lot of effort in providing access to the underlying annotation, so you can really go deep into what's behind whatever you find here in terms of potential interactions. There are over 2 million annotations. And you can use it either as a web server, but also there is a bioconductor package or a Python package or even a cytoscape module for this. So this is how we get access to biological knowledge. And then depending on the application at hand, you may use one or the other or a combination of resources. And the idea here is that the same way that when you are, let's say, wearing glasses, you try different lenses to see which was the best one for your eyes to see at best. Now, in the context of biological analysis, depending on the application and the question, you can, through Omnipath, try different resources and say, okay, we'll use ACSN, the great resource from Curie, for example, for a particular question, but maybe for another question, I would use a different resource. Okay, so that's how we use the biological knowledge from. And then we use this knowledge to extract, as I said, mechanistic signatures from different types of omics data. And I like to show this figure, especially for the more computationally people like us, because if you are just looking at the data in the computer, it may look all the same. At the end, it can all be just matrices of values of genes across into samples. But of course, every type of omics data is telling you something very different at the molecular level. So it's not the same to look at the proteomics or protein levels or metabolomics, small metabolites, or some modifications of, for example, proteins like phosphoproteomics, no? Or to look at the genes. So it's very important when you try to extract mechanistic features that you are quite clear about what type of data you have and also which experimental technology was used to generate it. And so keeping this in mind, we always try to extract, as I said, these mechanistic features. If you have genomics data, let's say you have exon sequencing and you know which genes are mutated in a particular cancer sample. So what you can do is to say, okay, instead of look at the mutation of individual genes, I will try to group them. I will try to look at mutations at the pathway level, because maybe it's not so critical whether this gene or this gene or this gene in this pathway that you see here is mutated, but rather that the pathway somewhere is mutated. So you can do this with a particular tool. We also spend a lot of time looking at transcriptomics. And again, as I was saying before, we try to think carefully what transcriptomics is really telling us biologically. So, and we think that transcriptomics is very helpful as some sort of footprint, molecular footprint of upstream processes, such as pathways or transcription factors. So many times when you try to understand if a pathway is active, you can look at the expression that. But the activity of the components of a pathway are also controlled by other things like, such as localization of phosphorylation. And this you cannot measure or get a sense of if you are just looking at the expression of the genes in the pathway. But you can if you look at the changes that happen downstream of the pathway. And for this, we developed a strategy called progeny to look at the pathways in this way. And actually, there is a nice paper from San Andres' group at Curie that compares also these methods and really shows how these kind of footprint methods seem to work particularly well, although you cannot always find these footprint signatures for all your pathway of interest. But if you can, it's a very effective way to estimate some gene expression if a signaling pathway is active. Similarly, if you want to estimate the activity of a transcription factor, you can look at the changes in the target genes. So this is the so-called regulome of a given transcription factor. The genes that we know are controlled by transcription factor. And again, this is normally more informative than the actual expression of the transcription factor itself. And without going too much in the technical aspects, there is a number of statistical methods to, once you have your knowledge of the regulons of a transcription factor, of the genes of a pathway, or any other type of network, there is a number of methods that allow you to estimate statistically from that and your data, this activity of transcription factor of pathways, and to facilitate, to try different methods and to see which ones works better, we develop a package which is available in this link here. And we're writing up a small explanation of this. I'm happy to tell you more or share with you if you're interested, to facilitate to try different methods with a particular data and a particular question. And the last thing on this expression is that once you have estimated activity of a transcription factor, and then you know or you want to know how upstream components drive those changes, you can use another method that's called Carnival that tries to find causal paths in large signaling networks that can be responsible for the changes that you see downstream of the expression level driven by, as I said, upstream modifications. And I want to tell you a bit more about this. So this is, again, the idea behind. You will take a large network. You can use OmniPath, our resource, but you could use any other resource directly or in combination. You have a network where you know which proteins are activating or inhibiting which proteins from the receptors on the top to the transcription factor of the bottom. If you have now expression RNA, you can estimate, as I just explained, activity of transcription factor and of upstream pathways. And this Carnival method will try to find the large signaling causal pathways that connect both and therefore explain you which mechanisms are responsible for changes. And just to give you an intuition of how this works, very basic, imagine a very small example. No? Imagine you have an active pathway upstream and an upstream transcription factor downstream. And if you look in these large time-directed networks, you will see that there are three possible paths that connect the pathway with the transcription factor. And you could think biologically which ones makes more sense. If you think about this for a moment, probably you will quickly say, okay, if this goes up, then, you know, if this goes up, but then this goes down, then this will not be able to activate. No? So probably the lower path is not the right one because there's an inhibition happening. So then if you activate here, I would see here a decrease. So if I think of the upper part, of the middle part, in principle, the both can lead from the activation of a receptor on the top with activation of a transcription factor at the bottom, but I would probably pick the upper link simply because it's the simplest model or simplest path. And that's how this method works. It tries to find the simplest path or collection of paths in a large network that are able to explain the changes that we see in upstream pathways and related to changes in downstream transcription factors. And this, of course, you don't need to do manually. There are advanced or very efficient algorithms for integer linear programming that allows you to solve this problem and therefore estimate in a very fast manner from a very large network which paths in your network are potentially explaining the changes that you see in specific components like transcription factor or upstream pathways. And one thing you can do with this method is, for example, you can now go back to the cell lines I mentioned at the beginning. So there were these 1,000 cell lines where I told you that we have all these omics, among others, the RNA transcriptomics. And I also told you that in a pure machine learning approach, we could only explain some things. So now I can try to come with my Carnival method. I have transcriptomics for all of them. So I can run the workflow separately. At the end, for one of the almost 1,000 cell lines, I will get a network of causal paths. And as a first thing, I can try to see if my estimated activities on proteins in the pathway, right, estimated from the expression, are well correlated with the efficacy of the drugs that affect those nodes. And the idea is that if a drug affects a node that is active, is more likely to work because it has an effect. If the drug binds to a protein that is not active, it probably doesn't matter, so the effect is much lower. So I can do this using the gene expression, but also I can combine this with the mutational information that tells me about which of the different nodes of my network are active or not. So I can combine mutational data to individualize for each cell line the starting network by removing nodes that are mutated, and then run this method to estimate the drug response. And actually, this is still work in progress, but I can tell you that it helps, and we find things that you will not see with other methods. But still, again, there is a lot of room for improvement, and I think in part is because from gene expression, of course, you only get an approximate estimation of the activity of upstream proteins. But we think it's a step in, hopefully, in a helpful direction. Now, I want to talk briefly about single-cell technology. So all the work I showed you was first developed for bulk RNA. And as we've been seeing, there is now a lot of single-cell data sets and approaches that can be used. And we wonder whether these methodologies work in that context. And as you know, like also Emmanuel saw this morning, in the case of single cell, you have these dropouts, you have all sorts of technical difficulties. And we did a very extensive analysis and benchmark that was published last year. I will not get into details, using both in silico and real data sets. We saw that these strategies, despite the challenges of single cell data, they also work there. And the basic idea behind this is that because these footprints methods look at collections of target genes to estimate the activity of something upstream, you don't need to have all the genes. So even if you have such a set of the genes, and even if there is noise, there is enough information collectively to give you a decent signal about upstream process. And then we have applied into different contexts. But what this means for those of you interested in single cell data is that now you can take data sets where you have, look at different cell types or different groups of cells, and you can run any of these methods. You can estimate pathway activities, transcription factor activities, upstream drivers. So you can estimate intracellular processes from single cell RNA. And also, as I mentioned before, in OmniPath, we also have a lot of now resources about cell-cell interactions. So you can also, from the same place, look at intra and intercellular signaling together. And to facilitate this, from OmniPath, we have a number of workflows that you can run to use different tools. The one I showed you from us, like Project Carnival and Dorothea, but there are other tools like TIE-DIE or NicheNet, which is very popular. I think, Ipsy is presenting now in the course. And I'm sure you will hear about NicheNet from him. So you can run all of these methods from OmniPath. And one thing that I want to say a few more words, because it's also quite popular in the context of cell-cell, single-cell data, and we wanted to understand this a bit better, is this question of using single-cell data to estimate whether two cells are talking to each other. And to look at this, we did a small tool called Liana that is a place where you can run 60 different tools to estimate cell-cell communication, also using 15 different resources, including CellPhoneDB and some others that are very popular. No, and an idea here, which is actually very similar to what I was telling you before about how to estimate transcription factors from expression data, is that on one hand, you have different places of prior knowledge, and on the other hand, you find different computational methods. And if you open any of these papers that develop different methodologies, each of them use a different statistical method and sometimes different sources of biological knowledge or different combinations of them. So with this Liana method, we provide all of this into one place, as I said before. So 15 different resources, 6 different methods. So in this way, you can try to better understand or better look at what is the different results that different tools can give you. And so in principle, all methods are trying to do the same. They say, okay, I look at single cell RNA. Here is a group of cells. Here is another group of cells. I look if a ligand is overexpressed in the first group of cell, and if the corresponding receptor knows some prior knowledge, so the cognate receptor of the ligand is expressed in the other one in some way that is statistically significant together with the ligand, this is, means that probably these two cells groups are communicating. And when we take one specific data set, this is some published colorectal cancer cell line, and we run all these methods on the same, again, 6 methods, 15 different resources, then you see that actually they give you quite different results. And which one is right? I don't know. We really don't have a good way to know what is the ground truth, what is the real cell-cell communication if all you have is single-cell RNA. And then this is something that we think is quite important to realize, because if you think about it, what's happening biologically, you know, is you have a particular cell and you have single-cell RNA. So you say, okay, it's expressing a particular ligand. Then I'm going to assume that if I have more ligand of RNA level, I will have more protein. And if I have more protein, whatever, a cytokine, this will be in the active form. But of course, the same thing that I told you before for the pathway is called here. No, this is not necessarily the case. And then also, even more complex in the context of cell-cell interaction, this ligand must be secreted, must diffuse, let's say in your sample in the tissue. It has to reach the target cell, interact with the receptor, and induce a response in the receptor. But you can imagine all these steps matter for a real cell-cell communication, but we really don't know about the intermediate steps, and all we know is the RNA cell expression on each level. So we really think that we need a ground truth for this. We have brainstormed a lot. We have talked to many groups. There are some ways you can try to approximate this. One thing that we'll talk about in a moment is spatially resolved data. So if at least there are ways to look at this when you know whether the cells are next to each other, but again, that's not everything. It has to be able to do all these steps that I just saw. So this is something that I think is important for all. Using these methods first, there are many methods. They give you different results. We don't know which one is right, which one is wrong. Maybe you can try different ones through Liana. And if you have a consensus signal across the methods, it's more likely to be true. But even so, we cannot trust this. And we think that in the lack of ground truth, you have to consider all these methods simply as hypothesis generation, and then you have to further validate experiment. Okay, are you with me? All good? Carl?
Yes, Julio, you're still here.
Okay. So that was now a lot of transcriptomics, bulk and single cell, but of course we are talking about multi-omics in this course. I want to now go to other omics, but following a similar idea to what I just told you about this concept of footprints, of what is changing downstream of a particular component, I can apply this to different types of omics data. So if I have phosphoproteomics, I can use this to estimate the activity of kinases. And it's the same concept. I don't look at the phosphorylation of the kinase, because I may not know how this affects its activity. But if I look at the phosphorylation of target proteins that I know are phosphorylated by mechanisms of interest, I can estimate this activity. The same thing goes for metabolomics. It's not in this picture. These are only signaling pathways and gene regulation. But you could imagine if you have metabolic pathway and metabolomics data, by changing, looking at changes in metabolites, I can estimate the changes in metabolic enzymes. And we have also worked on this. And so now what I wanted to talk is how we can combine all these different omics data in an integrated manner using biological knowledge. And for this, we developed, Aurélien Dugos, student on the lab, developed a methodology called Cosmos to do that. So let's imagine I have transcriptomic, phosphoproteomic, and metabolomic data. I could have only two of them, or I could have other omics data that we're also looking at. So then if in this case I have these three obtained with mass spec and sequencing data, the first thing I can do is I just discuss is to estimate the activity of particular processes, so from phosphorylation kinases, from RNA transcription factors, from metabolized metabolic enzymes. And then the idea of Aurélien was, okay, now let's try to connect this in a transomics manner, so a chorusomics, using this causal pathway analysis that I introduced before this carnivore. And as a case study, we had a great collaboration with Rafael Kraman in Aachen, Christian Fritz in Cambridge, Christian Colon, and just also in Copenhagen. And then they were able to first access from tumor nephrectomy, so kidneys are removed in the case of kidney cancer, samples of the tumor and the matching healthy, and also then do these different omics on this data. So based on this, Aurélien developed this tool Cosmos. And then, so the idea is then that you have a very large curveball that some omnipaths, you can add all possible sign-directed interactions. This is over 100,000. Because we are looking at metabolism, we added another resource from Recon3D and a resource from Peabox at Embol Stitch that give us additional information about how metabolites link back to proteins. So with this large network, what we do is then to map there the activity of kinases, transcription factors of metabolites based on the omics data. And then using this carnival, trying to find which links or which paths can explain changes. And then this give rise to the network on the right. It still is a complex network with 400 interactions, but certainly much simpler and cleaner than the one on the left. And then in this network, now you can zoom in and try to look in detail at how particular processes are connected across omics and across biological phenomena, right? So for example, you can think that a particular metabolic enzyme controls a metabolite, which in turn can bind to a transcription factor and control its activity and so forth. And if you look in the paper, you will see the details of some of these mechanisms, how we could interpret them and relate them to known facts or the models were our hypothesis for further analysis, which I, as I said before, and I want to insist all these methods are largely a way to generate hypotheses more than anything else. But at least we think with this method, you know, at least you get simpler, more interpretable mechanistic hypotheses to look in some more detail. And yeah, we are now looking at a larger cohort and we hope to learn more about kidney cancer on that cohort. So to summarize this part, so we really think this idea of the footprints is a helpful way to look at large omics data, because as long as you know how process of interest like activity of kinases or transcription factors affect the footprint, the different omics data, you can use the latter to learn about the former. As I mentioned for single cell, but the same holds, for example, for mass spec that also has missing data. These methodologies also work. If you have missing data, you can use it to estimate only with a subset of the omics, the activity of the kinase. And, sorry, I wanted to show this first. And basically by combining that with large networks and this causal inference carnival into this methodology cosmos, you can use it really to delineate at a multi-om level how different mechanisms are controlling each other and how this, in this case, in our case, in the context of kidney cancer, but also in other types of cancer. And all these tools are bioconductor packages. So if you like programming, you can use them in that way. But we also made a small shiny app that is user-friendly. So if you are like me, not a great programmer of R, so you can still load your data and use it to estimate the different things I showed you before in a relatively user-friendly interface. Okay, now I wanted to talk about space briefly because I think it's very exciting and also in the context of multi-om data. And I mentioned before that for cell-cell communication, having spatial information is really powerful. And there are all these technologies now giving us spatially resolved data, not many markers, proteins, RNAs, and so on. And this opens a lot of new possibilities, but also requires new methodology. And one technology we have been looking in particular of spatial data is spatial transcriptomics technology called Visium. In this case, you get information about small spots in the tissue that don't have a true single cell resolution. So there are groups of cells in each spot, like mini samples from the tissue. And then this tells you information about tissue structure and, as you will see, spatial interactions. But to complement in a multi-om manner and to try to overcome this limitation of the resolution, what you can do is to use also single nuclear RNA-seq, so actual single cell resolution RNA levels, but not with spatial resolution, so simply of cells that you have decomposed. And we also look in this context, another single cell technology, a single nuke attack, that is this technology that gives you information about epigenetic regulation and then the potential of cells that also can be used to link, for example, to genetic alterations such as genetic wide association studies. There is something we have been looking at recently quite a bit. Our major case study is not in cancer, but I think everything I'm telling you is totally translatable. So we had a very nice collaboration again with colleagues in Aachen, about Enhausen, Kramann lab, Costa lab, Milton's lab on heart failure. Because we're talking about cancer, the details don't matter, but at the end, you have different samples of different patients and some healthy control. But you can do, in principle, is try to do the same. You can say, okay, I will use my data, I will try to integrate this with biological knowledge, and this will allow me to better understand what's happening, which cell types are present, the resolution, and what is mechanistically happening. And for the mechanistic interpretation, you can use the tools I showed you before. So pathway activity, transcription factor, and so on. And in each case, basically in each dot, which is one of these little groups of cells, you can compute all your features of interest and visualize them. And that's already quite informative to understand what's happening. But that's not really the most exciting thing, because in that case, you are simply analyzing each dot individually and then visualizing the results. But that you're not really using the fact that you know which dot is neighbor to which dot. So you don't know how the location of particular cells affects the neighboring cells. So for that, you can use methods for looking at spatial patterns or to look at the interstellar interactions. And in particular, we were very interested in looking at cell-cell interactions. So we developed a platform called MISTI that allows us to dissect the effect of neighbors on groups of cells. So if you have a particular spot, which can be a group of cells if you use this technology, but can be individual cells if you use other technologies, how much do the status of that cell, so the level of the different molecules, the different pathways, how much depends on neighboring cells or in more distant cells? This is very important, as you can imagine, in cancer, because if you look at immune oncology, for example, it really matters a lot. This is a cancer cell, next to it is an immune cell. How are they talking to each other? Who is controlling whom? What's the role of maybe other cells, more stromal cells? So all these type of questions, you can address them very nicely when you have spatially resolved data with this type of methods that allow you to look at interactions. That is what we're very interested in. And again, this is not a cancer case, but to give you an idea, in this case, you're looking at different type of fibroblasts. You can think again something similar, looking at the type of maybe cancer cells or immune cells, and we're able to find out that a particular cell type, its presence is driven by the expression of another gene in neighboring cells, and then this gene was particularly released at the second type of cells, in this case, endothelial cells. Using these special resource technologies and some machine learning, you can start to understand how the composition of tissues of particular cell types is driven by particular messengers released by other cell types. And again, if you think of a cancer context, these can be mechanisms that you want to modulate with different therapies to, for example, reduce the growth of the cancer cells or maybe stimulate particular immune cells that you want to attack the tumor to try to treat it. Yeah, so that's what I wanted to say about the spatial technologies. And in the last 5 minutes, I wanted to talk a bit something different. So as Carl said at the beginning, we're quite involved in something called the Dream Challenge. And the idea behind this Dream Challenge is that you try to involve the community, scientific community as a whole, to address important problems, in this case, in cancer research. And the idea to do this is to build competitions or challenges where you allow everyone in the world to participate. And the idea is that, let's say I want to find a better way to predict drug response or a better way to classify patients, I'm giving people some training data that they can use to build their different methods. They build their methods, and then I ask them to predict some test data. And this test data, importantly, they don't know it, right? So it's really double blind test in that they're providing solutions without knowing the answer, and therefore it's a really unbiased assessment of the different methodologies, because you submit an answer without knowing this, while when we develop our own methods, we normally have all the data, so we kind of know the answer, which of course makes it very hard to be truly unbiased. And also you ask the participants not only to give you the answer, but to give you the code, so therefore you will have and improving in reproducibility. And this is a workflow that I will show in a moment. You can apply to many basic questions, but also you can apply to more clinically relevant questions. And for doing so, and to be able to run this on confidential data, you can use Docker or other virtualization systems to send the algorithms to a place where they can be run on the data that you can otherwise not share, right? So you cannot always share training data if the training data is from patients. There is privacy and other aspects to keep in mind. So in those cases, people don't even get data for training, but they submit the methods into a system where it's trained automatically against a given data set. And another thing that is very nice is something that you can learn what's called the wisdom of the crowd. So simply, rather than looking at what's the best method, you can look at all methods and you can see which global trends arise from the method. I will show you about that in an example in a moment. And you can find or build like ensemble models, which is an average of what the different participants propose. And that method normally is very robust and works very well because it kind of integrates the expertise from all participants. So this type of approach, as I said before, we apply to many different questions, more basic biology questions around gene regulation or about signaling pathways, similar to what things I mentioned before, mapping on spatial data that I also mentioned, or different type of biological networks, more on the context of cancer and cancer drug prediction. We run challenges asking people, can you predict whether a particular drug is going to kill particular breast cancer cell lines, very similar to the first part of my talk. Also for combinations, once based on gene expression, once based on a multi-omic approach together with AstraZeneca. And a more recent one I wanted to show you as an example, also because it's about multi-om, together with the CPTAG, which is a proteomics branch of the NCI TCGA. We tried to see if people could predict phosphoproteomic or proteomic from the other omics data. So the idea here is, right, we had some data, which actually, because it was from patients, we could not release, so we had to use this Docker approach. We have data from breast and ovarian cancer patients. We have DNA, RNA, protein, and phosphoproteins. And then we still have some data they could use for training and some testing data that we asked them to predict. And the question is, you know, following some of the things I was saying before, you would expect that to some degree the protein is correlated with the RNA, but you know, it's not the same. So can you use RNA and DNA of all the genes to predict the protein levels across the samples? And as a next step, can you predict the phosphoproteomic data? So can you predict changes in phosphoproteomic from protein, RNA, and DNA? And when we did this, a lot of teams participated, and then we then could look at what strategies work best. And this is a summary of the four top teams for example, prediction of proteomics. Of course, they use the RNA and the DNA data. They use different sources of biological knowledge, like protein interactions, or they look at protein families and protein structure and so on. So generally, it was helpful following the theme of my presentation from our own work. We use different sources of biological knowledge. And then they use a combination of different machine learning methods. And actually, yeah, they many of them also integrate in different ways to eventually estimate the protein level. So just a way how you can then learn for a particular problem. In this case, can you predict one omics data, proteomics, and all the other omics data? And then let the community participate and learn from the best ideas. And then you can then also not just look at the four best teams, but look globally how well people do or what works best, what doesn't work best. For example, we found that people model samples work well. And as I told you before, the use of gene interactions or and so on was very helpful. We also found particular proteins are harder to predict. For example, protein complexes are hard to predict, but metabolic proteins involved in metabolic pathways are better to predict. And actually, that is a pretty difficult problem. So the performance, if you look here, the Pearson correlation is not really great. But this means that, you know, if so many teams tried and nobody managed to do a very good performance, it's possibly something truly biological happened, and it could also be that biological aspects that we were not covering with our omics, such as translational control and degradation, were very important. But, you know, it's an example of how, again, this work, high-level or rather high engagement community effort can allow us to better understand what are the limits of computational problems, no? So what can be done, what cannot be done, what works better, what works worse. And with that, I'd like to finish. First, I'd like to thank the people on the team. So OmniPath, the resource of pathways, is mostly led by Dinesh. The different tools of pathways and description factors, Michael Schubert, Luz, former lab members, out of the drug prediction work, from Francesco and Michael, and the multi-om was Aurelian, spatial analysis mostly Jovan, and with Ricardo, and we have a large number of collaborators, both experimental and computational, and if you like what we do, we are always looking for students and postdocs. And I'll finish with some take-home message. So machine learning and omics, multi-omics, certainly a great combination for personalized medicine cancer, but there's still a long way to go. There are many things to do. I mean, that's in a way good for you. If you're learning this, there is work to be done in this space, in the right place. We think that the use of biological knowledge in different ways can be helpful. It improves performance interpretability. And in that sense, our approach is always to take, you know, generic biological knowledge, generic model. Normally what you find in databases is generic, it's not specific. But you can train it with patient-specific or cell line-specific data to make some patient-specific model that then you can use to understand better what's happening and to predict therapies. For all methods, I think it's super important to have some benchmarks to get an understanding of how well they're really working. That's not very exciting per se, but I think it's important if you want to be able to trust methods. It's also hard because we don't always have ground truth. Like in the case of the ligand receptor communication, I told you, it's very hard to know, but I think we have to keep thinking about this. And then in the latter part, I talk about spatial resolution and how this opens a lot of new opportunities to address important questions, also has challenges for computation. And finally, how this crowdsourcing, like in the Dream Challenge, is a powerful framework to really advance as a group collectively in developing of machine learning strategies in cancer. And with that, I think I am good in time, and I'm happy now to take these minutes to take questions. Don't be shy. I know online is even harder, but I'm really happy if you ask any questions. Thank you.